Tell us about what you know of Uber and your friend's experience with Uber.
Yeah, well, he's a driver and he loves driving. He says it's really easy and it's a good way to make money and it's really safe.
I love the experience. I especially love the Lyft line where you get to share it with other people, because not only is it cheaper, but I do love the communal aspect of it.
It's too bad that the taxi companies are trying to manhandle and lobby Uber out of Salt Lake right now, because it's a great service. I don't like to see that, because you know they're just trying to powerhouse them through law. But
What do you say to the complaint that it's like a two-tiered system where they're heavily regulated and Uber is not really regulated? Is that a fair argument?
Yeah, it's fair, and I think that rather than just pushing them out, they need to put motion for regulating that.
By now, most people have heard of app-based ride services like Uber, Lyft, or Sidecar. Venture capital-backed businesses that enable ordinary non-professional drivers to use personal cars as a commercial for-hire transportation service. It's almost identical to a taxi, and to many satisfied customers, it's a friendlier, much more reliable alternative to taxis. Dubbed as ride-sharing, the apps enable you to tap a smartphone and watch a driver in a personal car arrive within minutes to pick you up and carry you to any destination. It's always paid by credit card, so there's never a need to carry cash. And passengers can rate a driver's performance with a 5-star rating system. This is to keep a driver's behavior in check, so if a driver's rating falls below an average of 4.6, it's usually the company's policy to fire them. But on the flip side, these ride services have raised the ire of taxi drivers around the world. Cabbies competing with companies like Uber and Lyft have protested passionately against their new competitors, and sometimes violently. Companies like Uber and Lyft have also drawn the indignation among some regulators and, to a degree, the widespread public, with Uber being hands down the most notorious. Valued at over $41 billion at the time of this documentary, Uber has overwhelmingly become the highest valued private startup backed by venture capital of its time. But its public perception was tarnished in 2014 with widespread accusations of price gouging, spying on journalists, lawsuits accusing Uber drivers of raping, kidnapping, and assaulting passengers.
And it happened around 8 o'clock when a mother and her two children were crossing Polk and Ellis here in the Tenderloin when they were struck by an SUV.
When a 6-year-old girl was struck and killed by an Uber driver in a crosswalk, Uber denied liability. And then there's questionable insurance gaps that sometimes leave drivers uninsured. Is it all just hype?
The agitated Uber driver pulled off the highway at Alamany Boulevard after Chicas told him he was taking them too far out of the way. Then they say the driver pulled out a hammer and bludgeoned Chicas in the head. Today his lawyer says Uber should be held responsible.
Doctors have said that I have a very long road of recovery ahead of me.
Or are there reasons to be concerned over the new so-called ride-sharing industry and its part in a larger phenomenon of what's called the sharing economy?
I grew up in the middle class north of Baltimore, nice white upper class suburb. And my parents said, be afraid of strangers. Don't talk to strangers. Don't do this. Be afraid of them. And I just did not want to live my life being afraid of people. So my childhood was a long story of doing things that terrified me, just so that my life was not controlled by that. And one of the things I did was did a lot of hitchhiking.
I was a professional photographer for many years. I worked in advertising. And then I decided I wanted to do more editorial photography. And so I came out to the West Coast, and I was doing some work. Rolling Stone had just started, so I did some work for Rolling Stone. And then I got called back to the Midwest by my friends in the music industry, and we formed a management company.
Yes, I came to cab driving. And one of the reasons that I came was I figured there's nothing that I'm going to have to deal with when I drive a cab that can be nearly as crazy as what I've had to learn to deal with relatively cheerfully as a hitchhiker.
I'd been managing a Bay Area band called The Tubes, and I wanted out of the music business, and I was looking for a job for a while, you know, just something to do that was loose, and that, you know, until a real career change came along.
I started 37 years ago. I had a federal job as a bureaucrat, as a safety manager for the Department of Agriculture. So I've driven a total of 30 years, but beginning in 1976, and we had the Teamsters back then, and we were employees.
I went to Luxor because I was told that was the best cab company in the city. I walked into Bill Lazar Sr.'s office in my three-piece suit and a tie. I was a businessman, and said, I didn't say I wanted to be a cab driver. I said, Mr. Lazar, I want to be a Luxor man. He loved me right away. He thought, oh, good. So I became a Luxor cab driver.
Taxi driving has always been a tough job. San Francisco cab drivers had been unionized employees, however, from as early as 1904 up until the late 1970s. Their employee status meant they had rights under labor laws such as guaranteed minimum wage, meal and rest breaks, workers' compensation, and unemployment insurance. Through the union, they could negotiate other working conditions, including paid sick days, vacations, company-provided health care, and pensions. It also meant they had to do what the company said. If the companies wanted their taxi drivers to wear slacks, dress shoes, a hat, and a tie, the drivers had to obey the dress code. But when offered the choice to be either a unionized employee or an independent contractor, the taxi drivers were divided. Some preferred to be unionized employees. Many others saw the independent contractor status as an opportunity to earn more income and enjoy what they felt was greater freedom and flexibility on the job.
Because we were employees, right? No beard, no mustache, no jeans. Had to be dress pants, and you must wear a tie. Bill Sr. used to drive around in his Cadillac, and he had a radio in his Cadillac. If he saw you sitting on a hotel stand, he'd tell you to get out of the hotel stand and go take care of his customers. He cared.
I preferred independent contractor much more because I think many of us become cab drivers because we like the freedom. And when we were employees, the company actually would tell you you had to wear a cap, for example, at one time, and they would tell you when to go to lunch.
To federal and state agencies, the employer's right to control, whether exercised or not, is the most important factor in determining whether a worker is an employee or an independent contractor. The more the control, the more likely the worker is an employee. With employees, companies would have to deduct payroll taxes, guarantee minimum wage and overtime pay, provide workers' compensation, unemployment insurance, and possibly negotiate other benefits.
They wanted quick service in San Francisco, and as employees, we had to take it. Yeah, I mean, if you saw something, you could give the order back, but you didn't want to do that very often because you'd be on the street, you'd be out. So the companies cared about the public and picking them up, even deep in the avenues, wherever. If you were going out there to take somebody to the hairdresser, so be it. We had to take 15 orders at least a day off of the radio. If you weren't a productive driver, you didn't last. You were out. We turned in our money. We turned in everything that was on the meter, except the tips. And then we split that with the company 60-40, and they issued us a check at the end of the week. And so you had your tips, so you had walking around money, and then you got your check.
The whole time, we had this meter split. I mean, if you got a ride to Walnut Creek, you'd feel like you were be really dumb to run the meter, you know. You could get back, let's say it was $60. Do you really want to give the company $30? Or do you just want to take someone to Walnut Creek and show them the rate sheet and make the money yourself? And that's pretty much, so I didn't like being in a position of being dishonest or being incentivized to cheat.
When you're a union member, there are many benefits that accrue to you. A pension, for instance. Wow, now there's a concept.
We had sick and vacation days, and they were paid. And if you came there and your cab was not ready within 30 minutes, you could go home and they had to pay you the minimum wage. Paid sick and vacation days. You know what? I don't even think I could find that in the dictionary anymore. That's such a long gone concept for cab drivers.
What do you say to people who were union cab driving employees back then? They liked it and they said that one of the great things was getting paid sick days and vacations and...
Oh, that's great. I mean, and that goes with a lot of jobs where you are an employee, and there are lots of non-taxi driving jobs like that. And if that's a good point of view, if someone feels that way about it, more power to them. I didn't like it. And what I also found is if you were honest, there was something called high flagging, where to make extra money, a lot of drivers would take passengers and not run the meter. You were splitting the meter with the company, and that's how you'd make money.
The company I worked for went bankrupt in 76. I got out of the business, came back into it again in 1980, and by that time there was no union anymore.
40 years ago, 50 years ago, cab drivers were employees, and many of them were members of unions. And then in the 70s, when the whole yellow cab went bankrupt and the industry sort of imploded and everything went toward this independent contractor model, it became very difficult for unions to unionize the drivers and to drivers to organize themselves.
Very quickly, things changed. No longer did they have health care, no longer did they have pensions, no longer did they have any say in the terms of, or conditions of their jobs. Here in San Francisco, there was positive proof of that, because at that point, companies were free to charge drivers what they pleased for driving shifts. So even in the days of the union, a lot of drivers were working on a gas and gates basis, meaning that they paid a certain amount to lease the cab for the shift. And those lease fees started going up, and we tracked it for a number of years, and they were going up at twice the rate of inflation. So after a certain number of years, drivers were literally paying double to rent a cab compared to what they had when they were still unionized. And there was no restraint on it. The cab companies could raise these gates at will. They could treat drivers as they wished. There was nobody representing the drivers. There was no grievance procedure. There was no way for a driver to have any recourse if the company did something wrong or did something bad.
Once we were independent contractors, you simply rented the cab, and if you wanted to go take a 2-hour break or if you wanted to work all 10 hours, it was up to you and no one cared.
The regulatory system has in large part taken the place of the employer-employee relationship. So what we had was a public process instead of a private negotiation, and drivers' contracts really became part of the public process. But it's an imperfect and flawed process. It only could deal in large strokes with some of the larger issues, never get down to, you know, the nitty-gritty of, you know, driver's actual relationship with the company.
I can't think of anything good necessarily that independent contractorship necessarily brought, with the exception, of course, for the companies. They didn't have any benefits to pay. They, you know, it was much cheaper for them to hire independent contractors. One of the things they could always wave in the face of a lawsuit about that was, well, you can turn down any order you want. You can do anything you want once you're out the door. You're an independent contractor. When we dispatch an order, you can blow it off. And from that point on, taxi service in San Francisco started to go downhill. You couldn't get a taxi in the Deep Avenues. You couldn't get one in Hunters Point. You couldn't get taxis. The little old ladies and so on and so forth had trouble getting taxis because there was no investment from the company in servicing the public anymore.
This taxi driver had the, you know, the credit card sticker in the window. And then when he dropped me off, I handed him my credit card. He said, no, only cash. And I was like, well, you say you take cards, and I've only got a card. So he's like, I'll drive you to the ATM. I was like, you're not driving to the fucking ATM. I was like, you take the card or, you know, this is it. So we went back and forth, and then I was like, bro, I'm out of here, man. So I like opened the door. He came out and fucking like, grabbed my arm. Like I was like, are you sure you want to do this, man? So he finally let go, but it was like this overtly negative experience, dude. I was like, pissed, man. And it was like he's got physical, for Christ's sake, you know. So I'm glad, like, I don't have to deal with that anymore.
Passengers have complained for years that it's hard to get a taxi in San Francisco, but taxi drivers say it's been just as hard for them sometimes to get cabs. They say that's because most drivers must rent the taxi from a cab company, and the company dispatchers exploit that fact by manipulating them into paying higher cash tips to the dispatchers before allowing them to work.
I would love to be able to get a report back on how much the taxi drivers are still having to tip their dispatchers. To me, that was a real problem with the industry.
Do taxi drivers have to pay tips in order to get good shifts or good
push? Yes, yes, yes. Regardless of your schedule to drive a particular shift, if you don't pay $5 to $10, you don't get a good car, or you don't even get out at the scheduled time when you supposed to leave the yard. You could, if you don't tip them $5 to $10, even though you are scheduled to drive at certain time, you could be sitting at the yard for 2 hours. They'll make you sit there for a long time.
There was a guy whose name I won't mention because he's really pissed off at me for writing something about him. I actually liked the guy, but he was corrupt. Very, very talented musician, but you know, when he was a manager of a company and he got very corrupt. He was selling like shifts. If you wanted a Friday night shift, you had to, you know, give him $500 personally, and you know, you get people either doing that or not getting out at all.
If you tip them less, then they will give you old cab, which is broken down. There's a lot of trouble, or it could not even last you the whole shift, and it might break down between the shift, and so you lose money that way.
I came in one day and gave the guy $3 and you know, as a tip, and he threw it back through the window and said, that's not enough. And so I proceeded to show him what not enough was, and I stopped tipping completely. And I had a morning shift that started at 7, and I'd get a car at 9:30. I had cars where I don't even know what it was. Some huge pipe in the middle of the car. I just dropped out of it while I was moving. They'd give me cars with the brakes. The brakes would be shot. And I'm thinking, these guys are crazy. If I get into an accident, I mean, they're going to lose $1 million.
If you give them a good tip, they give you a nice car, new car. They send you right away, you know. So that's common practice.
I had this guy where it was one of $10 a shift to get out on a Friday night. And, you know, and I was one of a collection of people that wasn't paying them, but I got to sit around for 3 or 4 hours losing about $40-$50 an hour while I was not paying the $10, and there was about five or six of us were, some of them were old union people that refused to pay, and I just suddenly thought, what the hell, and gave him the $10. But the thing is that 2 weeks after I gave him the 10, he let me know that wasn't enough, so you know, he wanted 12.
Do you think that's some of the reasons why a lot of cab drivers have decided to go ahead and drive for Uber instead?
I think this is one of the big reasons why a lot of taxi drivers have left to drive for Uber and Lyft, because they don't have to deal with this company practice. You know, I mean, they can go ahead and drive their own car whenever they want, maintain themselves. They don't have to pay the gate, or they don't have to deal with the management or all the red tape. You know, companies just mistreated drivers. They didn't respect the drivers.
I'm sure that's one reason why a lot of drivers were finally leaving when they got a chance to go somewhere else, was the fact that they were buried on shifts, sitting there waiting for hours to go out and drive. They were systematically keeping people out, keeping people, having them wait for 3 or 4 hours in order to get them to give them a $20 bill.
Uber, Lyft, sidecar, and taxis. What services have you used?
Well, I've used taxis. I don't know what an Uber is, and I don't need a Lyft. How about you?
Okay. Just the taxis.
And what has your experience been like in a taxi?
I think they drive too fast. It's really fast. You gotta really, I slide all over the seats. I mean, I'm not used to city, so. It's probably normal for everybody else, but it's really fast for me.
Why do you use ride-sharing services like Lyft over a taxi?
Most of the time, because I never have cash on me, and some taxis don't take credit cards. And also, because it depends on where I am, there's no taxis available, and it's easier to just like pull out my phone and order a car to come than look for a taxi in the street or whatever. Mostly if it's like at night.
Which services do you guys use?
Uber.
Yeah. And what has your experience been like using Uber?
It's been really wonderful and efficient. It's incredible how fast they get to you and how it's really, there's no communication whatsoever. It takes all the awkwardness out of being in a cab. You know, like if you don't have cash and you have a card, that like awkward conversation you're gonna have.
Mm-hmm. It just takes all that away. You don't have to worry how much you're gonna tip them or how awkward that feels.
I like that it charges directly to your account because it doesn't really feel like you're spending money. And then when I was just in Paris studying abroad, and that was actually a really good way to get back, especially at night. The metro closes at like 1 a.m. or something. Taxis are actually pretty hard to find, so we would often, a friend who had the app would call an Uber car, and it was always really quick.
To me, they help me de-stress sometimes. You know, if you get a good driver, he might ask you, hey, you know, how's your day going? And that might lead into a conversation where I get to unload all of my stress of the day, where then I can go home and actually hang out with my like partner or whatever, you know.
Did you get that with a cab?
No, you don't get that with a cab at all, actually. Or at least in my experience, I haven't.
In Germany, where you're from, they prohibited Lyft and Uber. And you agree with that?
Yeah, I definitely agree with that because, I think it crashes down the cab industry, and I think usually cab drivers have, a lower standard of education, and so it's pretty hard for them to find different jobs, and I wouldn't find it moral to do that, to do so.
So you think the cab industry in Germany should be protected?
Yeah, definitely. By the state, it should be protected by the state, definitely.
I'm Matthew Ernest, founder of the Disco Lyft back in 2012, and I've been a TNC rideshare driver and advocate for the past 3 years.
People definitely see me and hear me coming. The Disco Lyft is a 2007 Toyota Prius. I can fit 4 passengers plus myself really comfortably.
The video on the roof, the smoke machine coming out the windows, the laser lights and strobe lights going on in the back seat, and the sound system bumping. And once they got in, okay, you guys ready to go? Cool, here's a microphone, let's do some karaoke. It is a pretty sporty vehicle if you want it to be. If they leave smiling, I'm happy.
So before becoming a Lyft driver, I was a event producer and did a lot of festival and concert management down in Southern California. After about 2011, the market shifted down there and a lot of the independent events kind of started going under. So I had to get my groove on, figure out what I was gonna do. So I started driving for Lyft back in June of 2012. And the app had just launched. It was very invite only. It was in beta mode. And the only way that you could get an invite was if you knew somebody who worked at Zimride Corporate. And it was a very small network of passengers at the time. I had started searching on Craigslist and was looking for, you know, event gigs to kind of make my break in the Silicon Valley tech event scene. And found a listing posted by Zimride for their new Zimride Instant product, which was called Lyft. And Lyft was it was posed as a peer-to-peer ride-sharing platform where people could request a car, and the drivers were compensated $18 an hour to be on call, to just hang out around San Francisco in the 7x7 and give people in the tech industry a ride from A to B wherever they needed to go, so within 60 miles. So it seemed like a good gig, and at the beginning, you know, we were only doing, you know, one ride every hour or two. So I was basically getting paid $36 to take somebody 2 miles, and it was great. But then once I started going out to places like the Sunset and the Richmond, you know, taking people out there on Thursday, Friday night around, you know, 5-6 o'clock, and then being available for somebody in that area to catch a ride back into the metro area, whereas, you know, taxi drivers wouldn't really respond to calls there in anything less than 2 to 3 hours on average. And, you know, taking a bus from that far out was a little risky, being that, you know, the Muni is known for chaos. And so that person coming back into the city was ecstatic to be able to have a car available on demand. Or even if we got pinged from downtown and we drove all the way out to the west side to pick them up and bring them down, we were on a flat hourly. So it didn't really matter to us where we drove because we were never going further than the 7x7. And these passengers were praising us because they, quote unquote, had their social life back and were able to make plans and have a reliable means of transportation, whereas, you know, taxis and buses really didn't serve us too well previously to that. I realized, you know what, this is a gold mine and there's a lot of value in a product like this for the community of San Francisco. I decided to leave my salary job to come do this full time.
My interest in this whole issue started several years ago when I saw a pink mustache driving down the street, and I was curious as to what this was about because I'd seen several. And so it piqued my interest. And I looked online, and then online I was seeing that there was this new developing phenomena called a rideshare. And when I looked into it more, I became very concerned about the safety of the public and whether the public would be protected in the event of a collision. And it became clear to me that they wouldn't.
Lyft basically goes into the markets that Uber is in and then gets folks who don't have commercial licenses and don't have commercial insurance and says, bring your own car and provide Uber-like service.
When Uber launched in 2009, it worked exclusively with commercially licensed and insured drivers, such as luxury town car drivers. People paid higher rates than a taxi for the on-demand luxury service. UberX launched in California in 2012 and is different from Uber's other luxury platforms. UberX's low-cost non-luxury vehicles compete directly with taxi prices and other lower-cost competitors like Lyft and Sidecar. But although it was a lower-cost service, more like a taxi, it was still a commercial service. So when it first launched, Uber, in order to comply with the law, required all UberX vehicles to have the same kind of state livery license and commercial insurance as a town car or limo. The licenses for UberX vehicles were permanently displayed on the bumpers in compliance with California laws. Insurance on a chauffeur vehicle can cost as much as $7,000 per year. So in San Francisco, UberX rates at that time were practically identical to a San Francisco taxicab, reflecting the higher cost of doing business. And at that time, Uber required UberX cars to be fuel-efficient hybrids. In that same year, rival startups Lyft and Sidecar offered a similar service but employed a much lower barrier of entry and low-cost strategy. Lyft and Sidecar let ordinary non-professional drivers in personal vehicles with no special licenses and no commercial insurance become what could essentially be regarded as a taxi driver. They called it ride-sharing and said that because it's ride-sharing, licensing and insurance laws governing traditional taxis and town cars shouldn't have to apply to them.
What happened was, like, they did it in California first, and I'm like, holy cow, every trip that's happening, I'm reading the law, every trip that's happening is a criminal misdemeanor being committed by the person driving. I don't think that's a good law, but that is the law. And so I'm just like, I'm kind of staying out of this one for a little bit. And watched it happen for a year, but what they were able to do because of, you know, no commercial insurance and because of their easy access to supply, the cost was really, really low.
Right.
And so you could see a situation where they'd eat you up from the bottom up.
Right.
And so stay on the sidelines, go, well, the regulators are going to do something about this. They ended up doing nothing about it. And then ultimately after a year saying, you know what, this is okay.
Right.
This is all right. And we ultimately signed an agreement with the state of California saying that. And so then we basically found a way to get what they call non-TCP licensed transportation providers.
Uber eventually joined in the competition with Lyft and Sidecar and dropped its commercial license and insurance standards for UberX. Like Lyft, Uber started letting UberX drivers use personal cars with personal insurance only and started calling UberX ride-sharing. And it didn't matter anymore if the car was a hybrid or a Hummer. In September of 2013, California became the first state to legitimize and regulate the new app-based ride services. California rejected the notion that UberX, Lyft, and Sidecar are true ride shares. Instead, the state ruled that they provide transportation services and classified the new ride services as transportation network companies, or TNCs. But the taxi industry felt the new rules laid out by the state were too lax and gave the TNCs an unfair competitive advantage.
You know, there's a lot of regulations they're not following. Cab drivers are highly regulated and they're competing for the same business and providing the same service, but not required to follow the same rules. We have to pay permit fees and 100% insurance all the time, commercial livery insurance.
If a pedestrian gets hit by one of these pink mustache cars, who's going to pay for their injuries? The city and county in San Francisco. That's who'll end up paying, because what Lyft and what Sidecar can do is turn their back and say, these folks don't work for us.
The whole game changed when you're telling your insurance provider that you went from, you know, collecting donations for like a casual carpool type situation, an on-demand casual carpool, I guess you could call it, to now being almost identical to a taxi. The only difference was, instead of having commercial licensed vehicles, we were using our own vehicles, but we were still operating under the guidelines of the state. But then the risk was much higher for us, because now our insurance companies see us as operating as commercial vehicles.
According to a report by the National Association of Insurance Commissioners, most personal auto insurance policies can deny claims and cancel policies when people use their personal cars for commercial profit. Up until at least the time of making this documentary, the anecdote is that many TNC drivers, if not most of them, conceal their commercial TNC activity from their auto insurers for fear of having their policies canceled.
Do you have to hide your Lyft driving from your insurance company?
Yep. Everyone does. I was actually just reading an article of some sort about TNC insurance gaps in coverage between personal insurance policies and TNC insurance policies. And toward the end of the article, whoever the author was suggested contacting your car insurance company to see if you're covered. And the fact of the matter is, while sometimes people find insurance reps that are on board with the CPUC's regulations and are comfortable with that kind of balance between TNC insurance and personal insurance, there's no company that is willing to insure TNC drivers unless they've come up with a TNC insurance product.
You may notice these mustaches are no longer on the front of the cars, they're in the windshields. You want to know why? Because they snatch them off if there's an accident, so their insurance company doesn't find out that they were on the job and engaged in a business activity. So why, if this model is so fair and so cool and so straightforward, is it being hidden from the police and the people who are out there doing the job and their insurance companies?
There are also allegations of TNC drivers getting into accidents, but then hiding the removable UberX or Lyft trade dress so that it never gets reported to their personal auto insurers that the accident happened while providing commercial services. That's because insurance companies can deny claims and cancel personal auto policies if the accident occurs while the vehicle is used for commercial profit. This video of a pedestrian being struck by a car was captured by a safety camera mounted to the windshield of a taxicab. The driver of the taxi alleges that the car was an UberX vehicle, but that after the accident occurred, the driver had removed the UberX trade dress. The anecdote being that the driver would not want his insurance company to know he was driving for Uber, and then deny his claim and cancel his personal auto policy on the grounds he was using his car for commercial profit.
I was actually taking a break going through the drive-thru at a fast food restaurant to get something to eat. I came out of the parking lot, and I was the third car from the light In front of me was a yellow cab. In front of that car was an Uber car. It was a Hyundai. And he was at the front of the light. Basically what he was doing was called jumping the light. When the light turns green, he wanted to go and make his left turn before having to wait for the oncoming traffic. And so when the light turned green, what he did is he jumped that light and hit the pedestrian that was in the middle of the street. And he didn't see her. If he did, he made no attempt to slow down until she was on the hood of his car. He struck her. She went onto the hood of the car. He stopped. She slid off onto the street. I waited till it was safe and I pulled up next to them and got on the phone to 911. As I'm doing this, he's having a conversation with the passenger. You know, I wasn't privy to what they were saying to each other. I do know that at that point she left the scene and went around the corner behind the fast food restaurant, you know, basically where she couldn't be seen. And as I'm talking to 911, giving them information about the pedestrian that was struck, the car, who was involved, that sort of stuff, I knew it was an Uber from the setup inside, you know, and I wanted to verify that. But at this point, he had already removed the Uber emblem from his interior windshield. I could see where it had been, but it wasn't up at that point. But I looked in, I saw all the telltale signs. I saw the phone holder, you know, on the dash and all that kind of stuff. And when I got through talking with the police, they had arrived, the fire had arrived, ambulance had arrived. I went over to the lady who had been in his car, and at this point I confronted her and I said, "You were in his car." She admitted that. I said, "You know, he's an Uber." She admitted that. "You were his passenger." She admitted that. And once she admitted those things, I went and got her and brought her back to the scene of the accident and gave her to the police basically to get her information, because I wanted that to be part of the accident report. The driver had not admitted that. He didn't volunteer that information at all to the police, and it wasn't until, you know, it was kind of undeniable from her saying where she was in the car and how they had met up and that sort of stuff that he, you know, divulged that he was driving for Uber.
Did he initially try to take that glow, the Uber?
It was gone, you know. He was in front of me, so there wasn't a point where I could see that it was there and that it had been gone. That was the first thing I looked for when I got in front of him, and I could see where it had been. So at that point, I wasn't able to 100% say that was an Uber until I went over and talked to the passenger, and she had confirmed that. So there was no disputing that it was an Uber.
Do you think these companies are encouraging insurance fraud? Do I think that these companies are encouraging insurance fraud? I don't know. I know officially they don't. You talk to an official representative, they'll have an answer for you. I think the circumstance is encouraging insurance fraud because there are several big kids on the playground. The TNC companies, the insurance companies, and the CPUC, and no one can agree on what the rules should be.
The issue of insurance was an issue that really came to light by the death of Sophia Liu.
It happened around 8 o'clock when a mother and her two children were crossing Polk and Ellis here in the Tenderloin when they were struck by an SUV.
On New Year's Eve of December 31st, 2013, when Uber was still relatively new, the Liu family was coming home from their grandmother's house where they had a traditional dinner, and they were going home to celebrate the new year. As they were walking down Ellis Streets and at the corner of Polk, they came to the curb where there was a light that was red for them, and they stopped and they waited for it to turn green, and they walked into the crosswalk, and suddenly a car made a right-hand turn. And Juan, the mother of Sophia, looked suddenly as the car was crashing into them and saw the driver looking down at a cell phone. And at that moment, the car driven by an Uber X driver crushed Sophia Liu, ran down her mother, and Anthony, her son, who was in the other hand, fell underneath the mother and was pushed along the pavement until it ground off his face.
When California first established in 2013 the regulations for Uber X, Lyft, and Sidecar, it required them to carry $1 million of liability insurance while their drivers were providing TNC services. But the new rules were ambiguous as to what it meant to be providing TNC services. This made it easy for Uber to say that although the driver who struck and killed Sophia Liu in a crosswalk had the Uber app on and was cruising around awaiting a fare, because he had not been matched with another fare yet, Uber claimed he was, therefore, not providing TNC services. Uber denied liability for Sophia Liu's death.
Uber was saying that the driver's insurance policies would be the insurance that would cover the activities that they were engaged in. In California, you were only required to have a $15,000 insurance policy. Yet this multi-billion dollar company was saying if our business actions cause harm or death, you have to look to the driver. And all you may find available, as was the case with Sophia Liu's family, is there was a $15,000 policy.
TNC drivers use their personal vehicles. However, personal auto insurance policies formally contain an exclusion for when passengers are carried for payment. This exposes the driver to a situation where he or she may have no insurance coverage at all for medical, property, or liability damage. There's great inconsistency in the industry on how TNCs define providing services.
Due in large part to Uber's refusal to accept liability for Sophia Liu's death, a new law was passed in California in 2014 clarifying when a TNC is considered liable. California divided TNC services into three periods. Period 1 is when the driver's app is on, but has not yet been matched with a ride. Period 2 is when the driver has accepted a ride and is en route to pick up the passenger. Period 3 is the time from when the passenger enters the car until the ride is complete. The California Department of Insurance had recommended that TNCs be required to carry $1 million of liability insurance for all three periods.
There was a bill, AB 2293. And that bill was designed to require them to have insurance in all three phases. And originally that insurance was going to be $1 million. Like any other commercial policy in this city in San Francisco, if you're in another form of transportation, such as a taxi, you have $1 million worth of coverage. If you're hit by that taxi during a period when they don't have someone in the as a passenger, there's $1 million worth of coverage. And that has been how the law has looked at consumer protection as it relates to publicly available transportation. But Uber wanted to say, we have no responsibility. When it became clear that this proposal, which was $1 million, was getting traction, they started flooding the capital with money. And their reason why? They did not want to have to carry any insurance. But if so, they wanted to diminish the amount of insurance that they would have to carry in this period one, which is the most dangerous period.
What finally passed into law was significantly lower. Although $1 million of primary liability coverage is required for period two and period three for death, injury, and property damage, only $50,000 of primary coverage is required for period one. That is the period in which Sophia Liu was killed. There is, however, a requirement for an additional $200,000 of excess coverage for period one.
This $50,000 limit is what the most that they would agree to, and they only did that begrudgingly because they saw the train coming at them. And it's the same reason that they've had in their business model all along, because they can shift that cost to the driver.
After over 2 years of insurance gaps and accusations of fraud, new insurance products have now emerged in California. At the time of making this documentary, Metromile is the only auto insurer in California to offer policies specifically designed for TNC drivers. But the policies are applicable to UberX drivers only. However, according to the National Association of Insurance Commissioners, more new hybrid insurance products are pending.
What are your thoughts on Uber?
You know, I have a lot of different thoughts. Initially when they first started, I was very angry about the whole thing, like most cab drivers are or were. I was pissed at the passengers for using them. I was pissed at the people who started it. I was pissed at the city for not doing anything, the police for not doing anything. And as time went on, I kind of came to some terms with the fact that they were going to be here forever. They're really not going anywhere. I don't blame the passengers necessarily as much for choosing Uber, sometimes, you know, basically what it comes down to is it's less expensive, and that's what people care about. You know, there are some issues with, you know, the history of cab service in San Francisco, you know, getting picked up and that sort of thing. I did blame a lot of cab drivers. We had a lot of bad cab drivers in the industry, unfortunately. We have a lot of awesome cab drivers, but we had our share of bad drivers as well. You know, doing things like screening passengers, not accepting credit cards, all that kind of stuff.
What has your experience been like taking a Lyft?
I think it's a good experience, but I think cab drivers are super pissed. And I think they're kind of right in a sort of way, you know? Because they pay to have a license, and nobody else does it. And the law required them to pay for a license. In Italy, for example, where I come from, the license is like $100,000. And then a kid would pop, but daddy bought the new car, start to make the same job without putting any money up front. You can just ask cab driver to pay for their license and allow anybody else to do the same job just because they own a car. It's not fair, that's all. But I think that's the way we're gonna go anyway, Lyft, Uber, because when there is economical crisis, everybody reinvent themselves in a sort of way to get more money, you know, and that's what's happening. So, and it's easier because you see on the phone where is your cab driver, you can call him and say, hey, look, I'm here, where are you? So it gives you a little bit of surplus of services that is gonna make a winner compared to the cab drivers, which, if they answer to the phone, they answer always like, well, who is there? What's going on? You know, they don't have customer service, they don't really care if you show up or not. So, if cab drivers start to give the same services as Lyft, you know, I would pick cab drivers more than Lyft.
If you could get a taxi cab the same exact way with an app and you could watch it coming on your phone, I mean, would that
Yeah,
be-
well, so I know that exists. I have a cousin who did that, and that worked really well. I don't know how the prices would compare.
If there were a taxi app, would you guys use that?
Absolutely, if it was a quick, just as quick. The thing about Uber that makes it fantastic is that it's very quick and efficient.
If cabs were as easy to get as an Uber or a Lyft, would you probably take cabs as much?
Yeah,
definitely.
Yeah.
In fact, I installed that new
flywheel.
I haven't used it yet. I haven't taken an Uber since then. I installed it like 2 days ago.
I used it just once, like a while ago, and it was fine. It worked. Cab driver showed up. I think the convenience is the big thing.
Have you tried flywheel?
No.
Do you know what that is?
I do. I've got a little $10 card, I think, in my wallet right now. It's like using
taxis.
Yeah, it's utilizing that kind of technology for taxis, though, so you can get like a taxi.
But why do you want a taxi?
So that's the point.
That's for you to answer.
You don't. It's too expensive.
And they tend to be ass. They tend to be, you know.
While app-based ride services like UberX and Lyft have improved the quality and reliability of transportation services for many people, some people are left out of the picture. Private transportation companies are amongst the industries subject to a federal law called the Americans with Disabilities Act. As the name implies, the Americans with Disabilities Act requires equal access for people with disabilities, including people in motorized wheelchairs. While UberX and Lyft can provide access to the deaf and blind, their services exclude wheelchair riders.
I started driving Crown taxis in Luxor since 2000 year. Yeah, it's almost 15 years. I came to Luxor around May 2000, and I started working with Luxor. And in 2 months, they offered me if I want to drive a van. I started working with a van because I feeling like I need to help the people. Sometimes it's people waiting 1-2 hours, even more. And it's pushed me, just memory of my mom. My mom was diabetic, and the doctor cut 1 foot, 1.5 year at another foot. And it was very hard for me to move my mom from one place to another place, especially to the hospitals. It wasn't in the United States, it wasn't my country. I was born in Moldavia, it's Eastern Europe. And every day, I tell you true, I pick up 2-3 wheelchairs. Sometimes I do it 5-6. The biggest number, it was 11. 11 wheelchairs what I pick up during my 10-hour shift. A lot of people, they know me. Even I tell you, they call me directly to me. I try to help these people because they are almost same guys like everybody. They got some physical problem, most of them. And I try to feel much better and not to spend so much time for waiting wheelchair. Some of them even cannot move out without wheelchair. It's very hard for them. And I try to help these people how much is possible. This is my goal, this is what I'm feeling inside my heart.
But what about Uber?
Uber? They don't provide service for, it's like discrimination. In my mind, it's discrimination. If they provide the service for people, they should provide for everybody. In my mind, this is discrimination.
The Americans with Disabilities Act prohibits discrimination against disabled people by private transportation services. But accommodating wheelchair riders is expensive because vehicles must be specially modified and maintained, and the drivers have to undergo special training.
I had driven for 25 years to get around town, go to work, and since about 10 years ago, I had to stop because of my disability. And so I've used public transit ever since then, full-time, literally, to get around. So I realized that things were difficult for me to get aboard the Muni buses, not knowing that I can utilize other services as far as paratransit. Because of the paratransit, we utilize the van service, and then also they offered the taxi service. And since then, I had to be using a wheelchair to get around. And I felt that relying on obtaining the ramp caps is difficult. It was very difficult even before the TNCs, the transportation network companies like Uber, Lyft, sidecars. I feel the impact of not being able to get a cab in a reasonable amount of time.
Okay, Roland, just coming overhead with the belt here.
Oh, okay. There you go. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, getting cabs, you know, ramp cab in particular is so challenging. Never know if we actually get a cab or not, you know, and sometimes they can't fill the orders because, you know, there's not enough drivers actually compared to cabs.
So how long you been a ramp driver?
Just about 7 months. Yeah, it's a really great service. I'm really glad that they have this. I didn't know about it until I was in taxi school. And then I went and got the training, and I've been able to help out a lot of people. It's phenomenal. It's really helping out, you know, people in wheelchairs. It's hard for them to get rides. It sometimes takes many hours for taxis to come out. So, you know, I'm really happy every time that I get to pick someone up. I have a lot of regular customers. They call me, and then they don't have to worry about waiting around all day.
Personally, I have never used the TNCs because it's not accessible.
So I know Uber used to have a wave button in their app, but I no longer see it there.
Hmm. Wave? W-A?
Yeah. Wheelchair accessible vehicle.
Mm-hmm. Oh, really? Yeah, don't know.
If you own a cab company, you are required to have a certain amount of what are called ramp taxis. And these are specialized taxis that are designed to provide transportation for people in wheelchairs. Uber doesn't provide that service. There is no requirement that if Uber has 1,000 cars on the road, that they have to have 10 cars that provide transportation to the elderly or the disabled. Uber does not participate in the transportation pool for the disadvantaged. So Uber is saying, in essence, we do not have to contribute to the communities that we're in. We just get to suck out.
Is there an option to get a wheelchair accessible ramp vehicle?
No.
No.
I'm trying to see if it'd fly over, but I'm strolling through it, no.
The taxi industry has, from the beginning, accused companies like Uber and Lyft of circumventing laws in order to maintain a competitive advantage. Equal access for disabled passengers
including wheelchair passengers, is an area where Uber and Lyft have failed to comply. Whether intentional or unintentional, avoiding the cost of wheelchair accessibility helps Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar to undercut the cost of industries that are wheelchair accessible, while also leaving the wheelchair passengers themselves underserved.
I wonder if these companies that are making great profits can't hire, as W-2 employees, a certain fleet of drivers who, instead of getting fair, get a guaranteed hourly pay. And maybe that means that they lose a little bit of money there, but then they have vehicles that can support these requests.
Despite the fact that you're a peer-to-peer model, do you believe and do you think it's in Lyft's best interest to forego that peer-to-peer model specifically so that it can meet the needs of the disability and senior community? It sounds like with tens of thousands of drivers and the popularity of the app and the advertising and all of this money that's gone into it, that it would seem that the money is there and that it's more of a, we're not regulated to provide these vans, we don't have to purchase these vans, that's not our business model, we will try. You've done research, you said, on this issue, and you've come up to the point where it's hard to find these drivers, and I think you understand why.
It would be different, but I think in the interest of, you know, trying to be able to support and transport everyone in our community, I don't think it would be that difficult.
So do you believe that it's in the best interest of Lyft to forego for just this population, which, you know, 15-18% of San Francisco plus 15-18% of seniors and elderly, to provide, you know, these vehicles in place and say, we know that we're peer-to-peer, but we know that this community is important to us. We want to guarantee that they will be served. Do you believe that that would possibly be in their best interest?
So Lyft has never owned a vehicle. Lyft does not operate vehicles on an hourly basis.
Right.
To me, Lyft is our peer-to-peer model. And so it is hard for me to imagine a scenario under which we would not be operating as who we are. That's like asking an apple to be an orange.
It's a really hard profit margin for these companies to really want to jump on board with, because they don't own their own vehicles or fleets. So they'd really have to partner with paratransit companies to have readily accessible vehicles on demand.
Members, Charles Rathbone, on behalf of about 800 men and women at Luxor Cab Company, I suggest that you advocate for a city fee or tax, if you will, a surcharge on every trip that Lyft provides. That money should go to provide accessible services by other operators who are actually willing to provide the services to you, not just to their idea of what a special client is, which means just about anybody except you. So provide those funds to operators that do provide the services. Contrary to what you may have heard, the city does have extensive authority to regulate these vehicles. The Public Utilities Code allows cities to provide what they call reasonable regulations.
These companies aren't really willing to subsidize the cost because, you know, the ROI is, you know, the return on the investment for them isn't feasible with their current business plan and the way that these companies work and make money. So they would be throwing out quite a bit of money if there was a law required, but at the same time, if it made life easier and better for those with ADA needs, you know, I feel that the investment is balanced.
I feel like if the companies are able to extend that service, I guess on their own without the need of the the government's eye, then they definitely should. If they haven't already, that's definitely something that all, you know, people that are trying to get anywhere need, because you never know who is trying to get to a certain place. So I definitely think that for that particular, I should definitely have that added, or an added service. I mean, I didn't know about that, but I'm definitely gonna, not like my email is gonna matter, but I'm definitely gonna email some, like, I'm gonna email and make sure that...
Do you feel that way, even though it could potentially cause your base rates to be higher, more like a taxi cab? I mean, right now their base rates are cheaper than a cab.
Right.
But it might have to make it the same as a cab.
Oh, I wouldn't mind if it's for equal... if it's for anything that has to do with an equal base of living or an equal customer service, I would have no trouble at all paying. I feel like nobody would. You know, if that's the reason, that would be definitely one good reason.
The California Public Utilities Commission, or CPUC, is the state agency with jurisdiction to regulate Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar. But what may be of concern is that on December 2nd, 2014, Marzia Zafar, the CPUC's Director of Policy and Planning, told transportation directors in San Francisco that California doesn't consider it a priority to ensure that Uber and Lyft become wheelchair accessible.
And so that's our number one. And then our number two, and it's not a priority, is the disability issue, to make sure that do we need to require the TNCs to have their own fleet for the disabled community. And then our number two, and it's not a priority, is the disability issue. To make sure that do we need to require the TNCs to have their own fleet for the disabled community.
What is it like being an Uber driver?
I love being an Uber. I love my passengers. I strictly love my. I look out for my passengers. My passengers are the greatest, you know, because I'm a disabled vet, and I suffer from PTSD, and I get sometimes I go through a lot of depression. So when I need to get out of the house, I go and I drive, and I get to talk to my passengers, and it's the best thing in the world.
These are not taxi drivers, but not long after taxi drivers protested Uber and Lyft, the Uber and Lyft drivers themselves followed with protests of their own. During 2014, Uber and Lyft engaged in a price war. Both companies slashed their prices to the point that drivers from both companies said their incomes were cut in half. The Uber and Lyft drivers who had invested in cars and made good money as full-time drivers now said they were struggling to get by.
It's become tougher and tougher lately to feel good about being an Uber driver because they've hired so many Uber X lately. I used to come into town at 4:35 in the morning and I'd get busy right away, and you know, I'd rock and roll, I'd make money and go home at 2 or 3 in the afternoon and make enough money. But lately I'm having to work 7 days a week, 8, 9, 10 hours a day sometimes to try and make enough money to pay the bills and support my wife.
Do you believe that most of the drivers that drive you for Lyft and Uber, do you get the impression that they are happy with what they're doing?
I know that they're not happy with the rates so much so because of the fact that Uber and Lyft have both maintained themselves affordable. They're definitely taking one for the team, for lack of better words. But I do think that overall they're happy because they definitely express a certain liberty and independence that you don't hear from peers, colleagues, you know, what have you, just normal people walking around the street that, you know, do more corporate type jobs.
Why turn for a company like Uber over a cab company?
Because I have a choice of when I want to work. I have a choice of when I want to work. I can stop when I need to. And I'm 66 years old, and I'm much older. So it's not for me to be out there all the time.
I know people that work for Uber and Lyft personally, and it is true what you're mentioning about the scheduling, about the rates. I feel that it gives a better opportunity for people, let's say, that are new to the country, that just got their credentials and all that, to get a better job opportunity and make $30 an hour instead of like a minimum wage pay that's $12 an hour.
Nobody's making more than $12 an hour. $45 is bullshit. Excuse my language. We want Uber to understand we are not making $45 an hour.
Uber has advertised in San Francisco that drivers can make up to $70,000 a year. Is this accurate?
They used to be able to make that.
They used to.
Because now, if you want to make that, you're gonna have to work. You're gonna put in so many hours. You don't have a life anymore.
At the beginning, everybody was excited about it, and can't believe even to join Uber. Now, be honest with you, everybody doing Uber, but his heart is already out of it. He doesn't like it, but he doesn't have any better option.
You are here because you're tired of lying when your passengers ask whether you like working for Uber or not.
The other morning I went out and I spent an hour and 10 minutes and I had one ride for $6. Okay?
$6 an hour, that's less than minimum wage.
Becoming really bad because the cars are getting more and more cars, especially Uber X's, without permits, and it's just crunching everybody. Not only black cars, SUVs, also taxis.
I have an issue because Uber is taking out all the town cars. I will have my town car out next year. I'm really thinking what I'm gonna do next year because. On the way, the business are. I'm not seeing myself working in this business because it's not worth it. I need to buy a new car. How am I gonna put like $30,000-$40,000 in a car, or assume a loan, and don't make enough money? Now I have my car paid off, and I'm not spending money with cars. But I will need next year. So right now it's already bad. Uber X's are growing and growing. So I think the business is gonna be worse, way worse. So how can I put like big money to buy a new car?
Uber has not done anything for the drivers.
Really?
As a matter of fact, we're under pressure now. We gotta change our 2010-11 cars because they just don't like those cars. They want higher, later model cars, newer cars, better cars.
So it's safe to say that Uber wants you to purchase a newer vehicle with lower income.
Exactly.
Make it much harder. Yeah,
it's making it much harder for us.
Do you feel like you're a partner of Uber?
I still feel because I'm still doing my best, but I'm not feeling that they have the same feeling for me.
I think that they should pay more emphasis, put more respect out for the drivers. I think that they should. The fees I have a problem with because it takes a lot of money to maintain a car. It's not whether they want to lower the price. When you lower the price, it makes it difficult for a driver. When he has a flat, he has a something, he has doing a lot of driving, you know? And it costs money. You know, I've had slashed tires off of these steel things that they put on the street. You know, it cost me $300 for a tire, or $200, $250, whatever, because you need to get back to work. You know, that's fine when you're sitting in the office and looking good and feeling good about the money you're making, but when you're out there struggling, you know, when you're out there struggling and trying to make things ends meet. So a lot of the drivers are finding it difficult.
The theory of having lower prices, generating more passengers is great. But if you're not controlling the demand and the companies are making a 20% commission of $5 or $10, I can do the same ride for $10 and give the company my 20%. Or I can do the same ride for $5 and another driver can do the same ride for $5. So that's $10 now out of two rides that these companies are gonna still make the same commission. So whether they make it out of, you know, 20% of a $10 fare for 2 miles, or whether they make it out of, you know, 20% of two $5 fares, say at 2 miles each. Now they've gotten 4 miles linear footage out of these drivers for the exact same commission, and the drivers are being now paid sometimes half in certain cities that they would have for the same ride a year ago.
What Uber is doing is saying, you, the customer, will pay us but a fraction of what this service costs, and we're going to pay the driver what they would have gotten before we undercut the price. So they're selling their service for less than it costs them, and they're doing it quite clearly to crush their competitors. And they've actually said that we have more money, that we can outlast and outspend Lyft and definitely the taxi industry. So what happens, people, if they succeed in, through their predatory pricing, in crushing their competition? See, competition is what this country is founded on. Competition is good, but competition that's fair is good. Because what Uber will do is drive out the other businesses.
Uber's trying to cut out Lyft, Lyft's trying to cut out Uber. They race to the bottom.
Yeah, but do you feel like you're the one that's kind of...
Yeah, we're the ones that are getting screwed. We're the pawns in their little game of...
As usual.
TNC, yes.
We do have the back of the Teamsters, but we need to unionize so we can get some regulations going. There's absolutely no regulations right now here. And at any given point, any of us can be deactivated, and they don't have to give us a reason. That's what they say in LA. They say that we don't need a reason to deactivate you guys. So it's about time that we stand.
So they've got a bonus, and the bonus is charging the rider less, but the driver gets subsidized. Well, they end up keeping that lower price for the riders, but they take away the subsidy. So it's like they're doing it like that. So you end up getting screwed slowly but surely.
But you must like getting screwed.
I actually wasn't with Uber when people got really screwed. So I started with a little bit less of the heartache.
What started out as something really exciting, really new, very profitable, is just little by little, everything that everyone loved about it is kind of falling by the wayside. And I spent a lot of time talking about how much I blame Uber for the price wars, but all of these companies are slowly disappointing us.
Yeah, the price cuts, that would be one of the ultimate lows. Just that they've dropped, and they've dropped again, and I believe if record stands, they've dropped 3 to 4 times already in the last 18 months. So that's painful because I'm having to work twice, sometimes more than twice as much, to make what I made a year ago, 18 months ago.
Well, what does that entail? How many hours a week or a day or?
About 14 hours a day. Lyft caps us out at 14 hours. So once we've been logged in for 14 hours, they log us out for at least 6 hours.
So because of price cuts, you're having to work 14 hours a day. How many days a week?
I normally go 5 to 6 days a week, at least. Yeah.
Why don't you just get another job?
Well, because you start doing it, you get a car to do it. I mean, I didn't buy the car essentially to do this, but I do now have a car that I'm doing this with. And when I signed up and it worked together, I went, oh, it's nice having a nice car, plus it's nice having this job. I enjoy this. I meet people. I really like the people I meet.
I mean, it's like any other job. You have your good days and your bad days. But, I could give it up. I could go back and work as an accountant again. There's plenty of open positions. But I like it. I still like being on the streets. I still like meeting the new people. There's people that I meet every day that I wouldn't have met otherwise, other than them getting in my car.
Do you worry about having some money to retire on, pensions and stuff like that?
Doesn't everybody? Especially after 2008.
But as a freelancer and as a self-employed person, I mean, is it harder?
And living in the most expensive city in the country. Oh yeah. But I've got a little place over here along Division set up. There's a guy, he's got a camp there, he's got a tent. I told him, I said, I'm going to be your neighbor.
That's
price
your,
cut.
That's your pension plan. That's your
my pension plan. That's
a
what I'm going to be.
On the sidewalk.
While many TNC vehicles are clearly fuel-efficient, low-emission hybrids, it's equally clear that a fair share are gas guzzlers. At the time of making this documentary, no independent research has been conducted to determine whether Uber and Lyft are increasing or decreasing traffic congestion and air pollution. In early 2015, Uber released data indicating over 16,000 drivers had signed up as Uber drivers in San Francisco alone. That's not including Lyft and sidecar drivers, the numbers of which are not publicly known. By comparison, there's only 2,300 or so taxi medallions in San Francisco. Despite Uber and Lyft's claims that they're simply utilizing empty seats in people's cars who are already on the road, companies like Breeze rents cars to people who don't have them, and rents specifically to people who want to work for companies such as Uber and Lyft. This suggests that Uber and Lyft could be adding more cars on the road, not fewer, in part because of the new style of rent-a-car industry. On the plus side, Breeze advertises hybrid vehicles, and hybrids should be the fuel-efficient, low-emission standard in California for all non-luxury, for-hire transport vehicles. Currently, this is the standard for taxis in San Francisco.
When the Taxi Commission was first started, and I was appointed to it to be the driver representative, really the first item that we put on the first agenda was clean taxis, was trying to figure out whether there wasn't some alternative to the gasoline-powered, really poor mileage Crown Victoria that the fleet was using. What it was in the old days, people would buy these old used police cars and run them into the ground, and it wasn't really a great technology up to date and as clean as we could have. And the Ford Escape was kind of the small SUV. That was going to be the first American hybrid. That came out in the fall of 2004, and we adopted it. And they worked great. They were fantastic. We went from 12 miles per gallon to over 30 miles per gallon. Driver's fuel costs went from $50 a night down to $15 a night. In 2007, I started thinking about, well, how would I actually write a law that would, you know, implement these vehicles and make them the dominant technology in the industry? How would we actually do that in the taxi industry? How would we actually make that commitment to reduce emissions that much? The truth is, it's about eighth grade science and math. It's not really that difficult once you can figure out how many tons each vehicle is emitting per year, or grams per mile, however you choose to measure it. So the great thing about this story is that we had no lawsuits. The drivers embraced this. The companies embraced it. The city officials embraced it. The fleet managers for the vehicles embraced it. And over a three-year period, we converted the entire San Francisco fleet to hybrid. And by my calculations, we, in 1990, this baseline year, were emitting about 75,000 tons of greenhouse gas emissions. By 2005, with the addition of all the new cabs, that was way over 100,000, more like 110,000 tons per year. By my calculation, in 2012, once we finished this conversion, the emissions of the fleet were down to about 40, 45,000 tons per year. So we more than cut emissions in half, even while doubling the size of the fleet. So it's an example, I think one of the few examples really in the last 10 years of a local jurisdiction taking a very explicit focus on greenhouse gas reduction and making it happen in a way that really benefited everybody. For me, I've known since probably 1988 or 1989, when I really started looking at this, that the buildup of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is probably the most serious problem that the human race has ever faced. And that if we don't do something about it really quickly, and that means in our lifetime, the lifetime of every single person living right now, that there was going to be catastrophic consequences for life on Earth and for all future generations. And so everybody has to do what they can do wherever they are. I mean, whether it's your own personal life or whether it's the job you work in, I found myself as this just cab driver being appointed to this position by the mayor of San Francisco as a taxi commissioner, where I actually had the power to get something done. I actually had the power to write a resolution at the commission and write an ordinance and work with the Board of Supervisors and the mayor to get it passed. And so for me, it was just the opportunity presented itself. to deal in a very substantial way with this problem that faces all of us. With Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar, their whole incentive is to dump as many vehicles onto the street as possible so that their customers won't even have to wait 30 seconds to get a fare. So there's no limit on the number of these vehicles that are out there right now. And, you know, because they've displaced the work of cab drivers and the hybrid taxis, to me, I think it's been a net environmental negative. Now, it's hard to get good data on this because the TNCs won't tell you what kind of vehicles they're using, how many vehicles are on the street at any given time, how many total miles per year they go. So the kind of carbon calculations and greenhouse gas emissions calculations that I did for the taxi industry really, to my knowledge, has never been done for the TNCs and maybe can't be done because they don't share that information. They're not very transparent in that way. So the whole idea that from 2008 to 2011 or 12, we reduced our emissions in the taxi fleet by 50,000 or more tons per year, that coincides with the rise of the TNCs. And so you have to take that into account because they're, in my opinion, just taxis operating without a license or a permit or insurance. So if you take all those vehicles into account, it's really hard to tell where we are.
Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar are providing reliable and friendly alternatives to the taxi industry. A taxi industry that's made up of a mix between amazing drivers who faithfully service their passengers, but with enough bad apples thrown in that overall, the industry often fails to adequately service the public. But in order for Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar to truly compete, they must play by a similar set of rules. At this point, it's fair to question whether a low barrier of entry is necessarily in the public's best interest. The carte blanche deregulated approach to Uber and Lyft has resulted in an oversaturation of Uber and Lyft drivers to the point that those invested as full-time drivers, whether they be TNC, taxi, or town car drivers, are now struggling to survive. One solution is to require fingerprint-based background checks for all TNC drivers. Fingerprint-based background checks are just one example of how to raise the barrier of entry for TNC drivers while implementing the gold standard for criminal background checks in California. New insurance products that offer personal auto insurance and endorse TNC driving should be required for all TNC drivers. It should not be optional. Uber, Lyft, and Sidecar must be required to provide the same on-demand service for the same price to the blind, the deaf, and to the wheelchair passengers, either by investing in specialized fleets of their own or by subsidizing other industries with already existing fleets. California cannot be dismissive of the rights of the disabled. If Uber and Lyft won't voluntarily make their services wheelchair accessible, California should require it. California should also set fuel efficiency and greenhouse gas emission standards for vehicles to qualify as a TNC vehicle. These are only some of the things that can help to level the playing field for everyone. And it won't put Uber and Lyft out of business. And as for labor, two federal lawsuits are pending in which Uber and Lyft drivers in California want to be reclassified from independent contractors to W-2 employees. Labor is to be decided in the courts.